So, a warm welcome to everybody who is live with us tonight. I'm very happy that we are talking about streams of legacy, the Danube in collective memory today. A warm welcome from me in the name of the whole IDM team. As you know from the program, we actually wanted to have our chair, Dr. Erhard Busek, with us tonight. Unfortunately, he had some technical issues and was not able to connect where he is located at the moment. But I'm hereby saying welcome in the name of IDM. It's very nice to have such a great panel with us that we could organize this together with the Austrian National Library. And I'm saying hello again and directly give my words to Dr. Hans Petschar, who is giving the introduction for the Austrian National Library.
Hello, good evening, everybody. A very warm welcome also from me on behalf of the Austrian National Library. My name is Hans Petscher. I'm the director of the Picture Archives and Graphics Department at our library. And I'm also representing the library officially in the Board of Directors of National Librarians. In the next few minutes, approximately 50 minutes, I will give you an overview on the actual exhibit we are showcasing in our State Hall in Vienna. For those who have not been able to see it so far, this exhibition is dedicated to the history of the River Danube and is titled The Danube, A Journey into the Past. And I will share my screen now and start this short presentation. And already. I have a problem because I'm. Can you see the screen now?
Unfortunately, not yet.
It's 1 minute, sorry. It was there and it's not there any longer.
Now we see it. Now you just have to open the presentation again.
Yeah, can you see it now?
We see the Explorer, so we see like a different kind of.
But you don't see the presentation.
Yeah, exactly.
Excuse me. So I think I have to open it again.
Maybe in the meantime, I can say a couple of words from my side. I am Magdalena Baran-Szołtys, and I will guide you through this evening today. I'm a literary scholar from the Research Center for the History of Transformations and the Department of Contemporary History at the University of Vienna. And I'm very glad and honored to moderate the panel discussion today. Thank you for the invitation. Maybe I will also say something how the evening will look like. So we start with this short presentation of director Hans Petscher about the exhibition, The Danube, A Travel into the Past, A Journey into the Past. I think that was the correct translation. Later on, we will move on to the panel discussion, which will start with short statements of our panelists. They will give a short 5 minute statements about the topic in the research area. And then we start go further to the panel discussion where I have prepared some questions for them. And later on, there will be also some time to have questions from the audience. If you have some questions during the presentations, during the statements, just feel free to put them into the chat and we will read them at the end of the panel discussion. Mr. Petscher, how is it going with your presentation?
Can you see the...
Not yet. We still see the Explorer.
Sorry, then I'll try it again.
Yeah, maybe you open the presentation first and then try to share the screen.
So now it should work. It's now you should have it.
Yeah, we see it.
Wonderful.
It's perfect.
Wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
So, Magdalena, thank you so much for helping me out in my desperation. And I start the presentation now. So what I'm going to present you is along some objects we have presented in the State Hall, the themes, and we are presenting in our exhibit, and which could then maybe help us for our discussion. In the last 150 years, the Danube underwent a profound transformation into an industrialized river. And in our exhibition, we show the importance of the river for the people living on and with the river before these great changes took place. In the first part of the exhibition, original objects invite visitors to view the Danube as a multifaceted historical and cultural space, and thematize also its functions as a connecting element, but also as a border and the importance of the river for the life of many people. By the way, the exhibit is still in Vienna until the 13th of January. So if you have the chance to see it, then you're welcome. Ship mills on the Danube, for example, were once an important industry that has long since ceased to exist. This one near Wilhering above Linz was painted by the famous Austrian painter Jakob Alt in 1848. But we also tell of the dangerousness of the river and of its fascination as a source of inspiration and imagination. Showcasing manuscripts, watercolors, and maps, which are exhibited for the first time in our library. Now, the Danube, the central European river with its west-east flow direction, has always functioned as a connecting route and provided space for settlements. In total, 2,888 kilometers stretch between its source in the Black Forest and its confluence with the Black Sea. On this map from the 17th century, the river was divided for reasons of space at the confluence with the River Drava. The personification on the right side of the Danube in the form of the river god Danubius is a popular allegorical representation on Baroque maps. However, the history of the Danube regions is also that of an area of conflict. Disputes over territory and supremacy characterize the entire modern area. The Imperial War Commissioner Heinrich Ottendorf had the order to travel from Buda to Belgrade in 1663 and to make records, which means to conduct espionage on the Ottoman territory. This sheet from the travel report shows Semlin opposite Belgrade. It was not until the beginning of the 18th century that reliable geographical information about the Middle and Lower Danube was available. The founder of the Danube exploration is Luigi Fernando Count Massili, an engineer officer in imperial service and private scholar. Massili devoted his main scientific work, scholarly work, to the Danube region, which he knew from 20 years of travel and research. In 1723, six volumes with their impressive copper engravings were published. The frontispiece of the second volume shows a reconstruction of the Trajan Bridge, built under Emperor Trajan in 105. After Christ. Zillen, so-called Zillen and Platen, were used as cargo ships on the Danube. They transported salt, wood, ore, stones, wine, grain, and cattle. These rowing ships were named after the places of origin, Kelheim, Traun, or Ulm. Good ships survived several voyages. However, many were cut up into pieces of firewood after a single trip downstream, because upstream they had to be pulled. For centuries, the waterway was the best and cheapest way of transporting travelers, goods, cultural stimuli, and knowledge. However, troops or emigrants were also transported on the river. Notorious was the so-called Wasserzug in German. The meaning is that in the 18th century, expelled persons were loaded onto ships and taken down the Danube into exile, especially to the Banat. Reports about Danube journeys, descriptions of the country and its people, as well as illustrated works, were widely distributed and reached an interested European audience. In the course of the 19th century, the unpredictable voyage on the Danube became a touristically interesting and commercially marketed journey. kilometers, the river flows from Passau to the Iron Gate, which is that section of the river which was in the Danube monarchy or formed its border from Passau to Orsova. A beautiful view shows the border village of Orsova with the island of Ada-Calais. This Ottoman enclave was flooded, however, in 1971 by backwater of the Iron Gate power station, which is in place there nowadays. This is Orsova, of course, I was too quick. And the view of Bratislava shows a ferry, which was called a flying bridge. Crossings and ferries were extremely important. In the area of the upper and lower Austrian Danube, there were only three bridges until well into the 19th century, namely in Linz, in Krems, and in Vienna. These were wooden constructions that were regularly damaged by floods and ice surges and were thus impassable until repaired for parts of the year. The Danube basin has always been characterized by an interplay between natural conditions and human intervention. Until the middle of the 19th century, the Danube was a dangerous and unpredictable river. Numerous rapids hindered navigation, catastrophic floods, and in winter, ice surges characterized life on the river. The flood of March 1830, depicted here in all its horror, was one of the worst ever to hit Vienna. Taming the river was a long process. For although plans were repeatedly drawn up and individual measures were put in place, the Danube remained unregulated in the Vienna area until well into the second half of the 19th century. On this view from the Leopoldsberg, one can easily see the strong branching of the river. It was not until the years 1870 to 1875 that a new riverbed was dug between Nussdorf and Albern, and the dangerousness of the stream was diffused. Parallel to the taming, the transfiguration of the Danube began. The Danube served as a setting for sagas, poems, and stories. It functioned as a motif for landscape and river depictions, as an imagined space of longing and stylized natural paradise. The river inspired musicians, writers, and visual artists. In our exhibit, for the first time, we show the unfinished symphonic poem Danube by Richard Strauss, and in addition, Danube texts by Ingeborg Bachmann and Andreas Okopenko, also a famous Austrian writer. From the series of 55 Danube views by Jakob Alt, I would like to highlight Freienstein, beautiful watercolor. Freienstein is located near Ips. However, the river does not only function as a metaphor for a mythical space of longing and desire. The Danube region became an integral part of leisure and adventure offers over time, already starting in the 19th century and going onwards to the present day. River cruises, the Danube cycling paths, natural parks, and local recreation areas make use of the Danube myth. At the same time, an awareness of the uniqueness of its natural area developed because regulation measures, economic use of the floodplains, and above all, the construction of power plants with their reservoirs massively changed the river and its surroundings. Now, the river was populated not only by and exploited not only by human beings, but also there are many natural spaces and also fish reservoirs living in the Danube. This is an example of a Hausen who migrated up the Danube from the Black Sea to Sporn in the 16th century. These Hausens came as far as to the Vienna area. They are the largest fish species from the sturgeon family and can reach a length of 6 meters. Today, their population is extremely endangered. Now, the second part of our exhibition in the State Hall is dedicated to a presentation of a very, very famous map, the so-called Bassetti map. As I said, for centuries, the Danube was an untamed natural space. The river and its banks obeyed the dynamics of water and the changing seasons, occasional flooding several times a year. This did not change until the 19th century, when the Habsburg monarchy set itself the task of taming the river and thus opening up a huge economic and cultural area. In 1857, the Imperial Royal State Ministry began this enterprise by publishing a map showing an extremely precise image of the Danube in the territory within the territory of the Habsburg monarchy from Passau to the Iron Gate. The map was named after the hydrotechnician and court official Florian Bassetti, who was responsible for the publication. Its purpose was to create public awareness of the political and economic importance of this waterway for the entire Austro-Hungarian Empire. Although plans were repeatedly drawn up and individual measures taken, the Danube remained unregulated in the Vienna area until 1870. After catastrophic floods in 1830, in 1849, and 1850, a Danube regulatory commission was set up. Most members preferred to create a new riverbed closer to the city, but the commission under the leadership of court official Florian Bassetti did not reach an agreement. On 14th May 1870, finally, Emperor Franz Joseph turned the first thought for the work on the regulation of the Danube near Vienna, a project that would cost almost 25 million guildens to the, in nowadays money, approximately 11 million guildens value at that time. At the same time, 5 bridges were built in Vienna, the Kaiser Franz Josef Bridge, the Crown Prince Rudolf Bridge, and 3 railway bridges. The work was done 5 years later, and the shipping services restarted when the steamship Ariadne carried the emperor along the new riverbed to Nussdorf. Now, this is an example of this Bassetti map showing the Schlögener Schlinge. The Bassetti map accurately depicts the course of the stream from Passau to the Iron Gate at a scale of 1 in 28,800. In the originals, this requires a cartographic representation of more than 36 meters. Numerous information on the condition of the banks, two-parts hydraulic engineering measures, navigability can be obtained via the character explanation. Hydrotechnical data, the possibilities of a crossing as well as the border of the floodplain are further relevant data. The stream is also correctly mapped in its north-south course using gore segments. You can see it on the right side here. These sheets and spandrels are arranged in such a way that a continuous map, a kind of Leporello or fanfold, can be produced. What we did was we digitized this map for our presentation in the highest resolution possible, enlarged it by 20%, and prepared it for a presentation in the PROMSAR. Starting from the central oval in the PROMSAR, you can now follow the Danube from Passau to Orsura in present day or Romania. These are two parts of the presentation as it looks like. And it offers the opportunity to take a journey into the past by walking along a 44 meter long presentation and seeing the Danube in its natural state as it exists no longer today. Which brings me already to the end of my remarks about this map. And of this mysterious count official Hofrat Bassetti, who came to Vienna from Veneto in 1845, and he for 20 years prevented the regulation of the Danube. Only after his permanent retirement, Emperor Francis Joseph was able to start the regulation of the Danube, not without giving a personal audience to Bassetti and to, quote, express the full highest satisfaction with his almost 51 years of faithful and excellent state service, end of quote. And this, all this and much more, you can read in our nicely presented exhibition catalog, which is still available, and in which, by the way, also the complete Bassetti map is reproduced. Our exhibition is also online in English in an extended version, together with the cultural platform Europeana and representatives of the European National Libraries from all countries the Danube flows through. We have created a virtual exhibition which is accessible on Europeana, and the link will be put into the chat. Take a look at it if you have. It's much more than the exhibition in Vienna, because we integrated also the other parts of the Danube flows through and some objects from other national libraries. So this would be the end of my presentation. Thank you for your attention. I'm hoping for a fruitful discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Petschar, for giving us this insight into the exhibition, especially for people who are not in Vienna and who could not until now see the exhibition. I have to admit that I watched it first online and I really liked it. So then later on, I went to the Prunksaal of the National Library, which I really enjoyed. And I was happy that I have a reason to go there again. And I really can recommend to you to go and see this exhibition. At this point, I would move the our evening to the next stage and go on to this panel discussion. And the topic of the panel discussion is the Danube in the collective memory. And I think we will open it up also not only for Austria, but also for other regions. And we have extraordinary experts here who will give us short statements about this. At this moment, I also want to thank Malvina Talik from the IDM, who made the concept and organized this conference. And she also invited this our guest. So we are very thankful that we can be here. So thank you, Malvina, for that. I think we will start with, we will go alphabetically, and we start with our guest, Daniela Apaydin. She is research associate at the IDM in Vienna, focusing on the issue of civil society, environmentalism, and cross-border cooperation in Central and Central Eastern Europe. She recently defended her PhD in history. Her thesis was focused on uncovering the transnational networks and campaigns of activists of the so-called Danube movement in the 1980s. Welcome, Daniela. May I ask you for your statement?
Yeah, thank you, Magdalena, very much. Thank you also, Malvina, for giving me the chance to speak in such a very renowned panel. I'm definitely the junior here in terms of my research, as I just defended my PhD, but I'm very happy because it has such a close relation to the Danube, and it's really my passion. I mean, I'm also working for the Danube Institute in this regard, so I'm happy to be here today. I didn't prepare a full statement or a talk because I'm really giving the floor to the more experts on the topic, but maybe I give a very short introduction on what I did in my research, what it has had to do with the Danube. And for me, a beginning when I read the title of this discussion, I thought that, yeah, thinking about the Danube, it's really hard to understand what is actually behind it. It's such a symbol, you know. It's kind of a mirror for me for the European history, for the history of the whole continent. And for me, the collective memory of the Danube shows like two sides. On the one hand, it shows the strength of this continent, the strength of its peoples, the cooperation in transport, in trade, in arts, as we saw very well in Dr. Petschar's presentation. And it's also a real pleasure to walk through this state hall in Vienna and to travel along the Danube in this exhibition, to see it all at once and to experience it physically at once. It's really a treasure to have that. But yeah, on the other hand, it also exposes the weaknesses of this continent with isolationism, with territorial disputes, seeing the Danube as a border, with exclusions, with ostracism and war and murder that is very much related to the Danube. And of course, for many people, the Danube also means these very negative connections in this regard. So, of course, it's a symbol for this blind capitalism and for extinction and for very, very big changes of nature. And we talked about the taming of the river already. But this taming of the river or this conquering of nature is kind of what brought me also to my PhD story or history PhD topic. Because I'm dealing with hydropower dams and with the activism against these dams on the Danube. And starting with this, we come automatically to one of the major events, let's say, or points of Austrian collective memory, which is the activism, environmentalism against the Hindburg dams in Austria in the 1980s as well. This was, I would say, one of the main incidents on the Danube when it comes to protest history in our country. It has become not just a very important event, but also kind of developed into a myth for the Green Movement, for the Green Party, but also for collective memory in general. It also, of course, has a lot to do with what media has contributed to this myth, and how it's kind of repeating it and constructing it over and over again whenever there are new environmental protests coming up, as we recently had or still having against the tunnel under the water meadows and the natural park of Vienna. So this is really a very, very interesting starting point for me to kind of look at this history of protest. But it's also a perfect example of how our collective memory often, and I'm talking about us as Austrians in this regard, stop at the borders. So as the Danube is not stopping, our collective memory stops here very easily. Yet the Austrian history cannot be just stopped at its border. It goes further. And my topic of the Gabčíkovo-Nádmoroš dam that was planned to be built in the Czechoslovakian and on the Hungarian territory in the 80s is an example for this. I don't want to go into details. I just show you very quickly a few pictures of that, just to give you an idea. Just a second. So you should see now also my presentation. I hope it works, and you can see the pictures of the construction site, pictures, original pictures from the 80s of the hydropower plant Gabčíkovo-Nádmoroš. It was a bilateral project between Czechoslovakia and People's Republic Hungary, and the plans of it date back to the Stalinist era. But was really starting to get realized in the 80s or early 80s. But the problem has always been between these two countries, the money, especially in the 80s and especially with Hungary having really tremendous debts at this time. So it happened that the neighbor country Austria joined this project, financing it. And also the Donaukraftwerke, which is today known as Verbund, have been the general constructor of this dam. So this happened, or the starting of this was in the mid of 80s. So exactly when Hainburg was also taking place, and in the end didn't work out because the protesters were successful with stopping this construction. So of course Verbund was very eager to use its expertise and to also use the engineers and the know-how and the machines and everything to build a dam, shortly said. And there it was very useful that also the neighbor countries have already plans in their drawers for it. But the Verbund, but also the Hungarians and the Czechoslovakians have not really estimated or expected a protest movement to be developed and to be formed against this. And it's a so-called Danube movement that I did research on it. And for them, the Danube was similar to Hainburg, a very important symbol of saving nature from capitalists, but also from their own socialist system. So it was very interesting that the Austrian environmentalists and the Hungarians joined forces in this regard for the sake of the Danube, and they were partly even successful. Not to go too deep into it now, but it is very interesting for the collective memory in media that it was depicted as the Hungarian Hainburg. So the discourses in media and the discourses and the frontiers of this discussion are very, very interesting research point. And you also see in one of these wallpapers of the Danube movement how the Danube was here depicted, and just the symbols of it and just the visual analysis of this is very fruitful, I think. But yeah, I don't want to go too deep into that. I just want to give it as a kind of an inspiration of that looking at protest history can be very fruitful for trying of discussing the Danube region and the collective memory here, and bring also this environmental aspect into the discussion, and the transnational or cross-border perspective would be really fruitful. So thank you for this.
Thank you, Daniela, for this very interesting insight into your research. I'm really looking forward to read your book soon on this topic, because it's also kind of very actual in the media, as you already said, here in Austria, because of the new protests of this national park and Stadtstraße, the street, the highway to Vienna, to the national park. So I hope we can discuss this later or in the discussion. So now I would, I have the pleasure to introduce our next speaker, who is Professor Marijeta Bozovic from Yale University. We are very happy to have you here. She is Assistant Professor of Slavic Languages and Literatures, affiliated with Film, Media Studies and Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies at Yale University, as I already said. She is a specialist in 20th and 21st century Russian and East European cultures with both comparative interests, which will be very interesting for us here. She is an author and editor of many books. Thank you, Marijeta, that you have taken the time to join us here and to share your knowledge and your research with us. I think you have a presentation you want to share with us. So
yes, thank you. Thank you very much. And before sharing it, I want to thank you, Magdalena and Malvina, for inviting me to participate in this event, which again is very, very close to my heart as well as intellectual interests. I wish I could be with you in person in Vienna and with this group gathered today. With that, let me go ahead and share the PowerPoint, which hopefully should be visible. Yes, does that show?
Yes, we can see it. Perfect.
Perfect. Thank you very much. All right. From its contested origins in Germany's Black Forest to where it flows into the Black Sea, Europe's second longest river connects 10 countries and its watershed for more. Navigable along the entire route, the Danube River serves as the artery of a culturally diverse geographic region and frustrates attempts to divide Europe from non-Europe, even as it facilitates the flow of transnational, environmental, economic, and cultural exchange. Cultural diversity along the Danube has long eluded stable political arrangement, nor have the lives of its peoples been easily distilled into the fraught modern category of the nation state. The boundaries and forms of the region's political organization appear transient in the longer sweep of history, over the course of which the river's flow has remained a rare constant. From the Romans to the Habsburgs, Ottomans, and Soviets, the multilingual and multicultural spaces of the Danube have been the site of recurrent imperial incursions. In the 20th century, the river witnessed a hitherto inconceivable marriage of violence and technology during World War I. World War II brought the unimaginable. After 50 years of Cold War and the fall of Second World Socialism, the river ran red once more with the shocking fratricidal dissolution of the former Yugoslavia. In 2004, the European Union's intergovernmental model claimed to be better suited to the ethnic and cultural diversity of the world's smallest continent. But today, unification appears tenuous. The brutalizing of the continent by violent nationalisms continues in the wake of refugee crises and the building of new Berlin walls. In Holderlin's hymn, this river is called Ister. It lives in beauty. Johann Strauss's waltz, The Beautiful Blue Danube, one of the most consistently popular pieces of music in the classical repertoire, was chosen by Stanley Kubrick for 2001, A Space Odyssey, made in 1968, to score humanity's technological conquest of the cosmos. An international symbol of human achievement, the Danube River has been endowed with utopian functions across languages and media. Transnational Danubian cinema has been as fascinated with what lies below the surface of the photogenic river as in its many reflections. It seems no accident that Vienna, one of the Danube's quintessential cities, was the birthplace of psychoanalysis. Below the reflective surface lurk dark histories and unprocessed memories of bloodshed. The Romantic River, now the industrial passageway of the EU, has also served as the dumping water for global trash, with all the term's ominous potential implications. For while it has been viewed as a metaphorical artery of civilization and an imaginary of world culture, Europe's river has also been a watery reservoir of bodies. As Dragan Kujundzic puts it, the non-biodegradable. Over the course of six decades, films have also pictured the Danube as the quintessential river of the Cold War. So I'm particularly interested in imaginaries of the Danube in the cinemas of and immediately after the Cold War. Here, in a mini version of a talk, are posters for six quintessential Danube films: post-war investigations of culpability after the river ran red, experiments with documentary and essay forms highlighting the river as a living artery, and two very different Danubian fairy tales in film. Tracing the river's imaginaries across a number of national and transnational films of and after the Cold War establishes the Danube as central both to the visual poetics of European otherness and to persistent dreams of an alternative transnational future. Carol Reed's masterful 1949 noir, The Third Man, follows pulp novelist Holly Martins to Allied occupied Vienna in search of his old friend, Harry Lime, played by Orson Welles, famously. Green based the vision on his own experiences visiting the divided city, incorporating along the way the inspired improvisations of one of the most talented actors of their time. The film's climax takes place underground in the Danubian sewers and ends with a shootout. The Third Man visualizes the start of the imminent Cold War, setting the tone for countless cultural productions to follow. The Luciferian Lime has been compared to Dracula, who I was also pleased to see made an appearance in Daniela's talk. And of course, it is notable that Bram Stoker's novel picks up speed precisely when Jonathan Harker crosses the Danube into Transylvania, bringing back evil like a spreading infection when he attempts to return home. Carol Reed's vision borrows from a rich tradition of Gothic tropes to signal to viewers that while this may be post-war Vienna, the real war has only begun. Andras Kovacs's remarkable and still politically challenging film Cold Days from 1966 moves forward nearly two decades and precisely to that imagined terrible place of prison to explore collective memory and moral culpability through the intersecting stories of four Hungarian soldiers and officers awaiting trial for the Novi Sad massacre of Jews and Serbs by the Danube's banks, the Razzia. Petr Horgács's experimental documentary, The Danube Exodus from 1998, made decades later, returns to the eve of World War II, asking us to set aside what we already know for a new affective journey along the Danube. Cobbling together several kinds of historical footage, Horgács reminds us that the river, always a conduit for exchange, served to transport populations of Jews serving passage to Palestine, as well as populations of Germans displaced by the encroaching Soviet army. A very different kind of documentary by David Barrison and Daniel Ross, The Ister, in 2004, sets philosophical discussions of Heidegger's legacy, beginning and ending with his lecture series on Hölderlin's hymn, against a journey upstream. 2004 was again a watershed year for Europe, a time of NATO expansion, of dramatic EU ascendancy, if not triumph, a much heralded turning point for a region with a history of violence. From the vantage point of 2022, the Ister already reads like a historical document as it follows the Danube River past Romanian celebrations over joining NATO, past the bomb bridges of the former Yugoslavia and new national parades, past the crumbling monuments to state socialism, past the concentration camps in Austria, the Valhalla Temple, Freiburg University, and into Germany's Black Forest. Somewhat similarly, Goran Rebic's many named film tells the story of the Danube riverboat en route to Romania from Vienna. The German captain Franz agrees to transport an orphan and the coffin of his mother, former Romanian Olympic swimmer Mara Popescu, back to her home waters. The ship's crew includes his Ukrainian first mate, Georgi, Serbian engineer Nikola, and Hungarian cook Tanya, and soon also Matilda, a young woman fleeing a heroin problem in Vienna. Also Mircea, a Romanian cowboy who tried to make it west across the river. Along the way, some fall in love, others fall out of love, and new multicultural families are formed. Bruno ends up deposited in Romania with Mara's welcoming but foreign family, whose language he doesn't speak, as Georgi sails the riverboat symbolically into the Black Sea. And then finally for today, Adina Pintilia's recent and short docu-fiction, Oxygen, from 2010, reimagines the story of a man who tried to illegally escape Ceausescu's Romania across the Danube. I'll show this image. The source material for the story, as was the case for Kovacs's Cold Days, is a particular event in a larger tragic history. Here, the story of a man who tried to escape Romania illegally and futilely by way of an oxygen tube and the river. The metaphor of insufficient oxygen is too close to the surface to need pointing out, but several aspects of Pintilia's film do warrant unpacking. First and foremost is the proximity of this depiction of the tragic crossing of the Danube to a number of films about similar attempts to escape Cuba, including the popular 2000 film Before Night Falls, starring Javier Bardem. Here too, the would-be escapee shows individualistic bohemian inclinations underscored by a striking soundtrack of free jazz. This view of the Danube, meanwhile, resembles an ocean far more than a river. Compared to other visual imaginaries that stress the river's flow, origins, and end, in other words, the linearity and directed flow of this body of water, Oxygen views the river as simply local water too wide to cross. More importantly, Pintilia's Oxygen demonstrates the not-so-strange resurgence of Cold War-era imaginaries in 2010, mere years after the integrationist fantasies offered by films such as The Ister and Donau, Donau, Donai, Donau, Donarea. Imaginaries of the Danube River once more tend to favor a view of the water as border rather than a living artery, with one side, as ever, representing the dangerous engulfing alterity of the East European other. And I'll show this as a final slide from some years back published in the New York Times. Following the flow of the Danube then, we have found the binaries of Cold War constantly subverted and just as frequently withdrawn. The indexical medium of film, dominant throughout the 20th century and so frequently profoundly transnational by virtue of its collaborative and diverse casts, crews, and production teams, serves as a mirror to the river's own reflective surfaces through the long, lingering, even resurgent Cold War era. In the 21st century, amid the resurgence of nationalism and the shirking of collective responsibility of the crimes of the past, Europe's most transnational of rivers remains ready to stand as witness in powerful imaginary once more. Thank you.
Thank you, Marijeta, for giving us this insight into this this other perspective and this other these other pictures of the Danube River. This was very, very interesting. So now, last but not least, I warmly welcome Professor Maria Todorova. Maria Todorova is Gutzel Professor professor at the Center of Advanced Studies, Emerita, at the University of Illinois. She teaches and researches the history of Eastern Europe, in particular the Balkans and the Ottoman Empire in the modern period. She's author of many outstanding and very famous books. One of it is Imagining the Balkans, which I think many of us have already read. I really enjoyed this book. Thank you, Professor Todorova, for it. I'm very happy to welcome you here, let's say in Vienna, but we are not all in Vienna. It's a pity. I hope we will meet one day again soon. And I'm really looking forward for your statement.
Thank you so much, Magdalena. And thank you yourself and Malvina in particular for this invitation. I'm actually privileged to be the last speaker because I can gladly agree and identify with what my esteemed colleagues have said before. I have no PowerPoint, I have no pictures, but I will take you a little bit back in history because I'm finally a historian. Our panel, I think, can be entitled The Danube Between Its Hypostases of Border and Bridge. But for different reasons nowadays, of course, it is proper to see the river mostly as a bridge or as a connector in a kind of transnational environment engagement. And I'm glad that Marijeta, in fact, evoked also the frontier hypostasis of Danube, which I think is its most natural and initial role. There is this wonderful book of Nick Thorpe, who wrote a lovely travelogue, sailing the river from east to west upstream. And he says, the Danube offers solace and preaches tolerance. So, and so it is maybe, but for the sake of just being contrarian, allow me a few skeptical notes. And I have grouped them in three. First, the space of the Danube, secondly, the geopolitics, and thirdly, the legacies. So the space, whose space does the Danube represent? The usual cliché is, of course, that it is the the longest, the second largest European river, but it, the premier river of the world, which connects 10 states. And of course, it is the main artery of the famous 16th century map, which Dr. Petschar surely knows and all of you know, the Europa Regina of Sebastian Münster, where it symbolizes the artery of a connected Europe and of a connected Christianity, but with the unmistakable hegemony of the Habsburgs being the head and the heart of this Europe. But is it really Europe? Jules Verne, who never saw the Danube, but wrote four novels on the Danube, wrote about it as this grand fleuve de l'Europe centrale. And he was an avid traveler who had been to all of Western Europe, North America, the British Isles, North Africa, all of the Mediterranean, but never to Central Europe. And his Central Europe novels were part of his travels to the center of the earth, to 20 leagues under the sea, and his travels to the moon, of course, that we've always enjoyed. And also let us not forget that Jules Verne's royal predecessor, the Sun King, Louis XIV, declared a manifest of war against the Habsburgs in 1688, when Belgrade fell very briefly under the Austrian troops, because it was considered that whoever has Belgrade would immediately conquer Istanbul or Constantinople. So I think the conclusion is that there was rather no Europe at the time. And in fact, Peter Berg, the famous historian, wrote in his article that there is no Europe before 1700. And the Danube as a symbol represents and still continues to represent a central European space. So it's a sub-region of Europe rather than the whole of Europe. And of course, this institute is called Donau, Raum and Mitteleuropa, which exactly makes my point. So secondly, the geopolitics. The Danube always had the function of a frontier and also a kind of natural barrier from ancient Rome and through the Byzantine Empire. But of course, we are more interested in the recent past and its legacies today. So in the early modern period, the 16th and 17th century, it was the theater of war between the Habsburgs and the Ottomans. And in the 18th century, it became a central pillar of the Habsburg ideology of expansion. From the 15th century on, once the Ottomans had conquered the Balkans, it was the channel through which they were expanding toward Central Europe. But at the same time, it also became a defense mechanism for the Habsburgs. And just to remind you, because most of you are German speakers, Sebastian Brandt would say, Jetzt sind die Türken stark. Sie haben nicht das Meer allein. Auch die Donau gehört zu ihrer Gemein. Sie brechen an alle Länder. Bistümer Kirchen stehen in Stande. Or later, of course, in 1558, in the Türkenbüchlein, you have, wenn wir verloren Donau, so stehen wir gar in großem Leid. And so this has been the refrain all throughout the 15th and 16th century. And this, of course, was totally reversed after the second siege of Vienna, when the Ottomans began their retreat and they incurred the first serious territorial losses. And the Danube then became a centerpiece of the ideology and propaganda of the Habsburg Empire, and at the same time also a powerful socioeconomic instrument. Especially after the Peace of Karlowitz, 1699, and until the end of the Habsburg Empire, really, especially after the acquisition of Buda and temporarily of Belgrade. In the 18th and 19th century, the Danube was no longer merely a river. It was a powerful space, and the two banks of which Vienna was beginning to consider its own. So my point is that it is a Austrian. It was a Central European and a Habsburg European space in these periods. For example, in 1664, the famous writer Sigmund von Birken represented, supplemented, and perfected a book on the Turkish Untergang, in which he described the advantages of the Danube for the princes of the Holy Roman Empire. He also proposed a model for the future of Southeastern Europe, in which the Muslims are driven out of the continents, and the lands from the Hellespont all the way to the Danube and the Dnieper become the realm of Christianity. And the liberated territories should be populated by settlers from the Holy Roman Empire of the German nation. So, beyond this the vision, so here is the geopolitics, what are the legacies today? I don't want to go much over my 5 minutes, but I can simply mark them out, and then I can come back to that in the discussion. But first of all, there are the real legacies, economic legacies, the federation plans of the 19th century, which were about the Donau realm. Secondly, and here I don't want to be facetious, but one of the most interesting to me and funny legacy are computer games. And nowadays, of course, the legacy of the Donau Federation is just amazingly represented in computer games and in alternative history. So it does live in the imaginary of people who are not interested in real history. But again, I will explain this because it's really a funny story. And then thirdly, of course, again, it takes up from Dr. Petschar is tourism, how the Danube today becomes a place for tourism. So let me stop here. I think I've given you the main outlines, and I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Thank you, Ms. Todorova, Professor Todorova, for this really interesting insights. Also about the games at the end. This was really something new for me. I think we are not really good in time. It's already 7 o'clock, and we already having one hour is already left. So we have only half an hour for the discussion. But I think we got a lot of insights from your inputs. And I think I would move to the round, to the last round of my questions which I had, which were connected somehow with the present. And this was further about the connection of the past and the present and the legacies. And actually, I would like to start with a question towards Professor Todorova. And this would be, what significance does the Danube still have for the Balkan region today? We already heard a lot about the Austrian collective memory, and also you spoke a lot of, a little bit about these legacies, for example, in the game, but also like in particular at the beginning of your talk about the region of Austria. But could you give us something also about this region and insight?
First of all, I don't think that there is a Balkan collective memory.
Yeah.
There is nothing like this.
Yes.
And I'm actually surprised that the Balkans usually go together. There is an Austrian
yes.
memory and then the Balkan version, a Balkan memory. There is no such thing. By the way, the one exception would have been in the Ottoman period, and I'm thinking of a recent book which came out by international authors published in Brill, but edited by a Greek and Romanian scholars, describing the immigration of Christians from the Ottoman Empire to Russia, to the Danubian principalities, to Austria, and it is called Across the Danube, where of course the Danube again is the frontier out of the Ottoman Empire. So it was revolutionaries, merchants, exiles who would go across the Danube, and they would settle. They would create an Orthodox diaspora called Greek Orthodox, but it was of course composed of Serbs and Romanians and Vlachs and Bulgarians and whatnot, but mostly Greeks. So it is this diaspora across the Danube. So here we have the metaphorical thing. It is the border of the Ottoman Empire. They're going out to opportunities and to liberty. But beyond that, it figures out only in the national imaginaries. I don't know, but out of my own corner, the Bulgarian, I can tell you that the Danube figures in the national anthem, and it figures in the only, I bet, the only song that Bulgarians can sing, and the song begins by saying it's the quiet white Danube gets animated, it flutters merrily, and so on. But that's the only song that people know, and so it figures out as this. It has its presence, but the presence again is dictated by the memory of the 19th century before Bulgaria became independent, where the Danube was the river which would allow people to go out in freedom, right? out of across the Danube, right? So revolutionaries would be in Wallachia, right, across the Danube. The other thing is, of course, how the Danube has been instrumentalized, but not today. As far as I know, today it is not so much instrumentalized. And I really liked Daniela's statement about the environmental protest, but I can tell you that as usually, this is a double-sorded thing because, for example, yes, you have these hydroelectrical power plants, but then you have the nuclear power plant, which is also on the Danube. And it is, and you might have environmentalists who would protest that, but in fact, Bulgaria highly depends on its energy on this nuclear electric plant. And if it is gone, the country which we will be in an abject loss of electricity and power. So again, it's again a double-sorded thing: how to use the Danube and how to use the nature. Okay.
Thank you a lot for this. For this insight, and I would maybe from your statement go to Marijeta Bozovic and give the question about this, the meaning of the rivers today in literature. You gave us a nice insight into movies of the last years from different countries. And would you say that this topic of the river is still fascinated, is still fascinating the artists, and what would be the different metaphors where they're used?
Thank you so much. I think the metaphors that we keep returning to in one way or another is border, or as Professor Todorova put it, frontier versus artery. And I think these are the two recurrent metaphors, or again, bridge, but you know, I like the flow of artery. So this is the contradiction of the Danube. And I think these are the fundamental imaginaries that recur throughout forms, throughout countries. In terms of its significance today, our rivers fading into the background, I think precisely because of climate change, no. I think we are afraid of floods again. We are afraid of diseases more than ever. We are as corporal as we ever were. And the ecological aspects, ecological activism with all its complexities, and also I'm fascinated by the political flips of ecological activism. This is something I was thinking about during Daniela's presentation as well. For example, thinking about eco-protest in Hungary, prior to the fall of the state socialist regime, eco-criticism, ecological protest is anti-state socialist and is visually presented as such. But then today, it's extremely anti-capitalist. And in some cases, it's the same activists, the same aging activists who have seen their politics dramatically change. I find this very fascinating. So in short, my expectation is that we will remain fascinated with the river, both literally and metaphorically, and that if anything, there is a resurgence of artistic projects that try to do something with the waters.
Just a second, what Marietta says, you shouldn't be surprised. There is a theory that socialism was state capitalism, right? So,
yeah, that's true. So maybe I give the word to Daniela, because I had a question for her also about what perspectives on the Danube are still missing in historiography, and also this connection about what Marietta said about eco-activism and what we already said a little bit after your presentations, the protests which are going on now in Austria, and where we have also activists which are like fighting on different frontiers, a phenomenon which already Marietta said before. Could you maybe comment on that a little bit?
That's a broad question now, but I kind of try to sort it a bit in my head. Maybe regarding the neglected stories or perspectives, I think I already mentioned a little bit of my perspective, that this transnational aspect is really missing, but also in especially particular speaking about my research on this very case of Gabčíkovo Nordmaroš and Austria's involvement. Definitely the question of a very broadly understood colonialization and Danube could be a very interesting kind of new perspective in this regard. Also towards environmental justice and the Danube, and also see the historical perspective of this environmental justice, of these ideas, also seeing the contradictions of this, as also Professor Todorova was mentioning it. Of course, in environmental protests, there's a lot of contradictions, and also in current protests. If I just refer to what Magdalena referred to, I think this interesting change from anti state socialism to anti capitalism. I did several interviews with activists who are past their, I would say, 50s, and have lived in both systems also and being environmental conscious in both systems. And they told me very often that they were first very, very optimistic that in a capitalist and democratic system, the environmental issues could be not resolved, but be negotiated better, and that looking back at this and comparing it with today, I felt very disappointed, and I felt a lot of, I would say, cynicism also partly, and frustration and resignation in this regard, because it was an anti-establishing protest, not necessarily an anti-system protest in this regard. So that's just for this as a side note. What could be interesting, I think, is to not see the Danube always as just a scene or a location or place where things happen, where history happens, but also understand it as an actor in history, and how the Danube itself shaped our understanding of the region, how it shaped our perception of history. And this is something, or a perspective, that I'm still a bit missing, because the let's say the Anthropocene, or the concept of Anthropocene is I think bringing this up of making animals the actors, making nature the actor, and try to make a perspective change to maybe get new ideas on how this human nature interaction is happening. And yeah, and then your question was to what does it mean today, or maybe compare a bit this past protest movements with current movements, like against the construction in Lobau or under Lobau. I think that the Danube, even if there are a lot of parallels to Hainburg, also it's also very often used as a reference point. I think the Danube doesn't play a role in this protest. I didn't investigate it extremely much, but as far as I observed, the Danube is not visible even in the protest repertoire. It's not playing a role in that, which is very interesting actually, because it would be a very fruitful thing to do for the campaigns to use this whole symbolic character of it, but it's not happening, and it would be interesting to see why. And just a hypothesis from me is because I think that the Danube doesn't play much of a role in today's negotiation processes at all. That's very hard to say if you work for the Institute for the Danube Region in Central Europe, but I mean, let's face the reality. I would like to have it different, to have a bit better conscious, but I'm afraid that there's a lot missing at the moment of this. I don't know how my colleagues see it.
Interesting. Yes, somehow they used the Danube, but not as the Danube, but the national park connected to the Donau.
Only the national park, yes.
Only the national park in context of the climate crisis, yeah.
So it's also interesting because the national park is, of course, part of the establishment. Or of institutionalized nature, you know, which you can also see very critically, but that's a different topic.
So, and now I would like to go a little bit to the end of the discussion on the panel and open it for questions from the audience, but I would have a last question to Mr. Petschar regarding the topics we discussed today. And as we say, the exhibition talks a lot about Danube's past and about the Danube that no longer exists. But what a Danube exists today, and what significance does it have for the present? We already discussed this now, but what can we learn from the exhibition and the past of the river for the present from your perspective?
Well, first of all, I was quite surprised when we prepared our exhibit and then finally decided to present this extraordinary map of Bassetti in the State Hall. And we had really to struggle how we could present it because it's so large. And it would, if we would have represented it in its original format, then we would have needed 8 meters high walls to present it, because of the Danube flows from west to east, but then also from north to south. And so and nevertheless, we decided to do that, and we were surprised which scholarly interest the map is even today. So we were working and are still working close together with the University of Vienna, who are using this map for georeferencing of historical maps, and also analyzing or the information which is there for the history of, for the environmental history of the region. So there is a large value in there, and what has been said by Professor Todorova and also Professor Bozovic, I mean, this is clear for us. We are, for us, all these objects we are presenting or representing, we don't say, well, this is historically true or this is not true, but what do we mean by real history? And this is, I think, if you want to write the history of the Danube or in whatever perspective, then you are confronted with, I would say, 80 or 90% imagination and only a very tiny part of real history. And still, this is what is preserved in museums and archives, and you can learn a lot in studying this object. For us, we had strong limitations because the State Hall is not an exhibition hall, and you are not able to showcase huge maps, which we do have, and we focused on the Habsburg territory. So and only in the virtual exhibit with Europeana, we integrated the other parts. I'm not sure if I would call this Central Europe, because how central is Moldavia or Ukraine and so forth. So you always face these difficulties in naming these regions. But I totally agree that for hundreds of years, this was a region of conflict and not of romance. and we had to struggle with this. With this powerful symbol, the Danube is as a space of desire and imagination, and to me still it's not if you compare it to the history of other rivers, let's say in the United States, here history of the United States. The shaping of the states, the rivers play a fundamental role. The Sabina River, the Red River, and so forth and so forth. And there are many similar histories you can maybe write if you analyze this, but none of them are so strong as a symbol as the Danube or became so strong. And this is still, I think, what is fascinating about this river, and maybe something But you said, Daniela, about the river as an actor. We have to think about that. But it's true that it's there, and the power of this symbolism is still there. And just the last word, the value or this topic of the Green Danube and environmental history, and you could see this map from Bassetti or the whole commission behind that, who were struggling for 20 years how to regulate the Danube, and if this would be an effort that you had to undertake nowadays, I'm not sure the regulation of the Danube in the Vienna region would have happened the way as it happened, because from a modern perspective, this old Count Councillor Bassetti is much more environmentalist than the whole commission at that time. And now the really last thing, this enterprise of regulating the Danube was one of the first efforts the young Emperor Francis Joseph in 1848 commissioned, which shows how modern this emperor at the very beginning was. He became a totally different person later. But he understood perfectly what the importance of doing of this enterprise. So.
Please, Ms. Todorova. Yes, muted.
I totally agree about the importance of the enterprise and the wisdom of Franz Josef. And of course, the European Commission was created in 1856 after the Crimean War. But who was the European Commission? And it was interested in regulating the Danube because the Danube at that point was a major commercial artery in Europe. It is no longer nowadays, and you can see how the fates of the river go with geopolitics. So once the commission was created, it codified the way the delta should be regulated. And who are the members of this commission? Of course, the great powers. Austria-Hungary, Austria, Britain, Russia, France, Italy, and the Ottoman Empire. However, the Ottoman Empire, on whose territory the Delta was at that time, had no say. So international lawyers and historians today are speaking of the Danubian Commission as a unique thing, which was exterritorially imposing a kind of semi-colonial imposition on the Ottoman Empire. 1878, when Romania becomes independent, it is also allowed in the European Commission. And Karol the First and then the later kings of Romania are desperately working for control over their own territory. And finally, they get it in 1939 with the Sinai Agreement, which nowadays is a sovereign territory of Romania. But at that point, the Danube has lost its economic role. Until it had an economic role, of course, it was the great powers who had internationalized it for their own interests. Just to add a little bit.
Thank you a lot. Maybe we can also, we still have 5 minutes left. There are some questions from the audience. Maybe I will read one of it. What is the role of the Islam on the Danube versus the Volga? Does someone of you want to answer to this question?
I mean, it's too broad a question. So, Islam on the Danube was important as long as it was the channel for Ottoman expansion and then the channel through which the Ottomans were kicked out. So I don't think that in the sense that the Ottoman Empire was essentially ousted out of this region, I don't think it would have a role. The Volga is different, of course, because you have a huge Muslim pop. You do have also Muslim populations in the Dobruja, around the Delta, around Galat, and so on. But I don't think that they play a role for the Danube, as it were. And I don't think that Islam has been held as a symbolic issue for the Danube at all. In fact, it was Christianity which was always imposed as the winning, as this quote that I gave you, that the Danube and the Dnieper should be the realms of Christianity. In the Volga, of course, you have a little bit of a different history. And even nowadays, in terms of tourism, which is extremely important both on the Volga and on the Danube, I don't think that Islam is figuring prominently. In the Volga, it is mostly the Russian story which is promoted. On the Danube, it is again. I mean, the Danube, you have the Viking River cruises, which Marijeta would know because PBS is the only television in the States which doesn't have advertisements, but that's the one thing that it does advertise. And the Viking River cruises are founded by a Norwegian billionaire who has a Harvard MBA, who made his money on the Russian equity market, who created the Viking River cruises in the 1990s. He's based in Switzerland, has a profit of billions of dollars nowadays, and employs thousands of employers. He's the president of the company. His daughter is the vice president of the company. So really a very international thing, and they are targeting wealthy American retirees. Now, wealthy American retirees are not interested in the Lower Danube. They're interested in Johann Strauss, in Vienna a little bit. They're interested in Budapest. And then they do go possibly through the Sulina Canal. They end up in Istanbul and back. But they are really not interested in the connecting ideas of how the Danube could be altered together, and definitely Islam is not playing any role there, as far as I know.
I might jump in with a quick footnote that it's interesting to think how the situation changes, however, if we begin including as part of the larger imaginary of the Danube, the various tributaries. And rivers and water flows that come into it, because then we can bring in the Drina and bring in the space of Bosnia and that local Muslim population. But that involves expanding our imagination of the Danube rather than linear connecting artery to part of a water network.
Thank you. It's a pity that we are almost at the end of our time and that we cannot discuss much more of the questions I have prepared. I think at least we have discussed like 10% of it. And it's also a pity that we can now meet and have a glass of wine together here in Vienna. I hope this will end shortly. I think everyone has the hope. I want to thank the panelists and the audience for the time, for sharing the knowledge and for being here. And also I was asked to say a couple of words about the photo contest, which IDM has. It's with the hashtag Life Along the Danube. And you are asked to submit photos from the Danube and post them with the hashtag, and selected photos of them will be exhibited in Vienna at the Volkshochschule Landstraße on June 29th, which I learned is the Danube Day. I don't know if you haven't known that. I think there's a link in the chat with more information to this. And I'm very happy for the time spent in the last 1.5 hours with you. Thank you for all the information we joined with you, and have a nice evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Magdalena.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Lovely meeting.